Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I am going to respond to a video that has gone semi-viral. You could actually say it's gone viral, depending on your definition, of course. A woman, a broadcaster from India, who has perpetuated falsehoods, really. Monstrous falsehoods, one after the other. Blunders, she's made blunders, mistakes, speaking with authority where she shouldn't have done so.
Yeah, Mohammed Hijab, we will see about that. Judging from your history, if you win a single point, if you come close to win a single point, it will be a total success for you. But there is no chance, my friend.
And I'm going to be reacting to this video of this woman speaking about the Afghanistan situation, about the Taliban, about the Sharia law. In fact, the video is entitled, "What is the Sharia law?" So let's assess, in watching this video, whether this woman understands that which she's talking about.
There was a time when Afghanistan was a modern state. Faith was a private matter.
So already we're talking about modernity, right? So there's an assumption from the very outset that Western modernity, progressivism in that sense, is potentially the barometer or the standard that we should meet. Well, these assertions or these assumptions have to be evidenced in and of themselves. We don't need to go towards modernity or progressivism or Western culture. And if you do want to put us in that kind of category of going towards this and you think that's the right thing to do, then you have to argue for that from first principles. It's not good enough to just say, well, it's modernity and assume it. You have to argue it from the beginning.
Afghanistan, before the Taliban imposed their version of Sharia law, was an objectively better society. A person who cannot even come to terms to admit that, he's totally useless to make any kind of analysis. Mohammed Hijab already took himself out of the debate. The comparison is not a Ferrari with an Aston Martin. The comparison is a Ferrari with this car. If a person cannot find it in his heart to say a Ferrari is a better car than this, then he is not equipped to make articles in a car magazine. Okay. The same way, if Mohammed Hijab cannot even say Afghanistan following a Western social model is better than Afghanistan with the Taliban, then he is morally handicapped and in no position to make YouTube videos about moral issues. The blunt truth is, political Islam, as translated with the Taliban, completely destroyed Afghanistan. Of course, Mohammed Hijab will never admit that because he is an Islamist. Islamists only care about Islamic supremacy and to continue feeling happy in their psychotic delusion. They don't care about Muslim or human suffering and well-being.
And I come to you with arguably the most controversial concept in the world.
It's arguably the most controversial concept in the world. Of course, it's not maybe befitting for me to outline the fact that controversiality does not equate to falsity. And I'm not saying that she's saying that, but just to make sure that our audience or the end user here is fully familiar with this point.
Of course, controversiality in the case of Sharia certainly points out to falsity. If something is so antithetical to moral common sense, is certainly wrong when it comes to morality. Morality, exactly because it's related to suffering and well-being, is deep-seated in human conscience. Controversiality in such level when it comes to morality is certainly a huge indicator of falsity. I will argue conclusive indicator of falsity for many good reasons.
But is it the most controversial thing in the world? I mean, there are lots of things historically and contemporaneously that have been more controversial. The shape of the earth has been extremely controversial on the history of cosmology in the last 1,000 years. Even more controversial, you could argue, is sati, a practice called sati that was done by Hindu women historically and even up until the modern age, actually. And this practice involved a woman burning herself in mourning for her husband's death. talk about women's rights, talk about all those things. It took the colonial powers, the British powers, to come and outlaw this thing. The white man to come and tell you what was right and wrong. Yes, no wonder why you're so obsessed with the white man, because he stopped you from burning yourselves. I mean, I understand the inferiority complex here.
Yeah, but how is that an argument for your case? According to what you said a few seconds ago, we cannot say burning a woman at the funeral of her husband is morally detestable. Isn't that what you said? Unless you said, unless we prove that from first principle. You made an argument against moral common sense few seconds ago. Moreover, this practice is wrong in your worldview just because Allah didn't say so. If Allah prescribed that in the Quran, you would have accepted that the same way you accept so many other common sensibly immoral things in the Quran as we speak.
But let's not try and think now that this is the, once again, the barometer that we must all fulfill, or the standard that we must all meet, the white man standard.
Mohammed Hijab keeps calling simple moral truths as white supremacy, when in fact he doesn't accept simple moral truths because of Islamic supremacy. He presents his moral blindness due to Islamic supremacy as Western supremacy. But let's take the example he just presented. Is it truly banning the practice of women being burned alive at the funeral of their husbands an expression of Western supremacy? No, that's simply moral common sense. Is the Islamic obsession against human rights, moderation, and multiculturalism? No, it's an expression of blind submission to Islamic supremacy. Let me give you an analogy. Mohammed Hijab claims calling this car red is white supremacy. No, the car is simply red. That's a simple moral truth. A simple truth. You doubting the simple fact that this car is red is an expression of your Islamic supremacy, Mohammed Hijab. Mohammed Hijab, just because you are a Muslim, that doesn't mean simple moral truths became controversial. Okay, just because an Arab in the 7th century wrote a book, that doesn't mean suddenly humanity don't know anything about morality and everything became controversial. That doesn't mean suddenly 1 plus 1 became 25.
Why is it so controversial? Why does the world fear it will take Afghanistan further back in time?
What do you mean by the world? Do you mean the white man? Is that what you mean? Or the Western powers? Or colonial powers? Or ex-colonial powers? Or the superpowers? Who do you mean by the world?
Mohammed Hijab, you are a complete idiot. I thought he wouldn't have been that dumb to support the Taliban. I mean, what's that? My dog. Wait, where? Over here. I didn't know I had a dog over there. Where were we? Mohammed Hijab, you are a complete useless idiot. She means humanity, everyone that accepts moral common sense and moral reason. Human moral common sense and human moral reason. Progress is real, and it means from something worse to something better. So we have progress in technology, social progress, moral progress, etc. Because the human species have reasoning, progress should have been inevitable. Unfortunately, every positive evolutionary trait comes in pairs with a negative evolutionary trait. The negative evolutionary trait to our intelligence is dogma. Dogma stands in the way of progress. Proponents of dogma in human history are the enemies of humanity. Simple, guys. They are not part of the human body. They are the enemies, the cancer to the human body. Those enemies of humanity, of the human species, of human progress, some of those enemies were Nazi. The dogma of Nazi attacked humanity. Islamist. The dogma of Mohammed Hijab attacks human progress and therefore humanity. Communist. The dogma of people like Stalin attacks humanity. We, the Greeks and the Indians, and my Indian friends, are proud to represent human progress based on human reason and moral philosophy. Glory to the proud Greek and Indian nations. Glory. Okay.
Okay, let's keep listening.
We've spoken to a lot of scholars and experts to put this report together.
You've spoken to a lot of scholars and experts, so I'm expecting what you say about Sharia law is going to be something which is academically robust. And if not, then you will be, obviously, to blame.
You idiot! You just supported morally the Taliban. Okay, you've proven her point. You idiot! You already proven her point. You idiot! You just supported the Taliban, my friend. You proved everything she will say about Islam. You already proven that, Mohammed Hijab.
Thanks to the misrepresentation, manipulation, and misuse of the Sharia. By whom? Islamic regimes, politicians, clerics, radicals, terrorists. They've all used the Sharia to rule in the name of God. So coming back to the question, what is the Sharia? Well, there is no...
That's not the exclusive property of religious discourse. Many radicals and terrorists have used secular ideology to do the same thing. So this is not an exclusivist discourse here. I mean, we can point to Stalin, we can point to even Lenin, we can point to Mao, we can point to many different people who had materialist ideologies and who did the same thing. So this is not an exclusivist discourse. And you shouldn't make it seem as if it is.
Mohammed Hijab divides the world between materialists versus people of faith. That's a completely bogus dichotomy. In contradiction to Islam that focus on rituals and material stuff like fabrics and facial hair, while rejecting any product of the soul and mind and smashing the willing and thinking process, Western values includes real spirituality based on philosophy and art, while at the same time including real religiosity in Christianity and Judaism. So that's a bogus dichotomy. The real dichotomy is the forces of reason versus the forces of dogma. Stalin and Mao were on your camp, the forces of dogma. It's not in our camp.
Where do the rules come from? Three sources: the Quran, which is Islam's holy book, the Sunnah, which is basically the deeds of Prophet Muhammad, and the Hadith, the sayings of the Prophet.
This is the first major blunder. It's actually a huge blunder. It's the Quran, the Hadith, which is the Sunnah. I don't know why you've separated the two things. And then the third thing is Ijma', which is consensus. And the fourth thing is Qiyas. And actually, Najmuddin al-Tufi, who is one of the specialists of the principles of jurisprudence, or Usul al-Fiqh, he mentions 11 sources altogether, including Listihsan, Istishab, Shara' man qablna, Qawl al-Sahabi, the saying of the Sahabi, or the rulings of those who came before us in terms of the other legal systems of Moses and, for example, Abraham and so on. Maslaha, which is the idea of the common interest. All of these things are also sources of Sharia. And this is the reductionist understanding that has left a lot of people like yourself reducing the Sharia to just one or two sources. This is not the case. And in fact, you haven't even represented it correctly according to any school of thought.
Islamic reasoning is under the shadow of revelations. Therefore, not really reasoning, but apologetics. Islamists make societies with hindsight Islamic supremacy, not human well-being. That's exactly the reason the Taliban cannot compromise to social progress. Islam has cursed, in a sense, Afghanistan to an endless vicious cycle of suffering. To break this cycle, we need to defeat political Islam. If USA understood that the ideas of people like Mohammed Hijab is the real enemy and not Afghan soldiers, USA could have won this war. But until the liberal West stops protecting the ideas of Mohammed Hijab and fighting the people who fight those ideas, political Islam will remain strong and Afghan people will continue to suffer.
Shia or Sunnah? This is completely false. What you've said there is wrong. Listen to me carefully. What you said there is wrong. Because, once again, to reiterate, the four major masadir Sharia, if you like, or the four major sources of Sharia are the Quran, as you've mentioned, the Sunnah, which is the Hadith, which itself is subdivided into different types. Authentic, sahih, yeah, mutawatir, sahih, hasan, hasan li ghayrihi, daif, mawdu', matruk, so on. And these categorizations are known by the people of Hadith. And then you have ijma', which is a legal consensus, which is defined by or as the...
Mohammed, we care. I'm so touched with what you are saying right now that I will open a humanitarian institution. We care.
The consensus of the jurists in one specific time, in one specific issue, in one of the issues of the Islamic law. This is ijma', and then you have qiyas, which is legal analogy. For example, if something is haram in the Quran, but then there's something which also has the same causative reasoning, they analogize onto it. For example, alcohol is haram, also wine is haram, let's say. They analogize onto that smoking weed is haram. Anything that intoxicates, hallucinogens are haram, because it's maqis alay, it's analogized onto. And this is one of the masadir, if you like, one of the sources of Sharia. But these are the four main ones. There are other ones like maslaha and mafsada. This is actually a source of Sharia. Maslaha is the common interest. A lot of people are asking, why is it that the Taliban are acting in a more pragmatic manner now? It's because of this source. See, if you knew these things, then you'd know how to operate and how to interact with those who you disagree with.
Islam can never produce prosperous societies exactly because it undermines human reasoning. It puts human reasoning in a box. Let me explain how that works. Let's say I want to change the lamps of my room. Logic says that I can use a ladder and change those lamps. Islamic reasoning will insist we need to change the lamps using pillows. So Islamists start to rationalize. Okay, we need to put this pillow like this, then we put the other pillow like this, then the third pillow like this, put the other pillow like this. Okay, so they are reasoning under the commands of Islamic revelations. So their reasoning is handicapped, is under some framework. Okay. That's why it's impossible to change the social attitudes of Taliban, because they don't reason with hindsight human well-being, they reason with hindsight Islamic supremacy. They reason how the Islamic scriptures are true. Can you understand now what's going on?
Όταν αγγίξεις την κορυφή και τη ρίξεις και έχεις την τύχη με το μέρος σου, κρατάς την πορεία και φτάνεις στα όρια. Μα όταν γλιτώσεις από το βάρος μιας πτώσης και δεν μπορείς να σηκωθείς, τότε δεν βλέπω να έχεις πολλά περιθώρια. Φτάσε στον πάτο, εκεί που δεν υπάρχει πιο κάτω, και βρες την ευτυχία κρυμμένη, κομμένη και ραμμένη για σένα, που κλαίσε κάθε δόση. Ισχύσε τη ενώση ψυχή μου και έλα μαζί μου στον πάτο. Όταν παλέψεις κι όλη τη γνώση μαζέψεις και ετοιμαστείς να απογειωθείς, καιρός του κράτης τι κάνουν τα όρημα φρούτα. Φόρα το κράνος, πάρε ανάσα και θάρρος κι αντιπρό στα πάνω να κοιτάς. Κλείσε τη μύτη σου, φτάσε στην άκρη και βούτα. Φτάσε στο πάτο, εκεί που δεν υπάρχει πιο κάτω, και βρες την ευτυχία κρυμμένη, κομμένη και ραμμένη για σένα, που κλαις σε κάθε πτώση. Ισχύσε τη ενώση ψυχή μου και έλα μαζί μου.
Στον πάτο. Στον πάτο.
Στον πάτο. Εκεί που δεν υπάρχει πιο κάτω, και βρες την ευτυχία κρυμμένη, κομμένη και ραμμένη για σένα, που κλαις σε κάθε πτώση. Ισχύσε τη ενώση ψυχή μου και έλα μαζί μου στον πάτο. Σε κάθε πτώση ζήσε τη ενώση ψυχή μου και έλα μαζί μου στον πάτο. Εκεί που δεν υπάρχει πιο κάτω, και βρες την ευτυχία κρυμμένη, κομμένη και ραμμένη για σένα,
που κλαις σε κάθε πτώση. Ζήσε τη ενώση ψυχή μου και έλα μαζί μου.